You think I'd let him destroy me and end up happier than ever? No fucking way. He doesn't get to win.
It's affected by it too, okay? I mean, it's every guy's worst nightmare getting accused like that.
Can you guess what every woman's worst nightmare is? I'm gonna make a
mistake. Messed up.
You don't tell me to stop crying. This is my body and you have no idea what it's like.
I want to be great or nothing.
The shadow hated the girl.
Obviously, Doctor. You've never been a 13-year-old girl. And if you wanna make sense,
what you looking at me for? I'm no good at math. So, my montage editing skills may not be up to par with the 12-year-olds on fandom TikTok, but I hope that that montage gave you a good idea of the energy and the presence that I'm trying to bring today. That is my cat Momo. Say hello to her. This is also the third time I'm recording this entire thing, so I do have a glass of wine in my hand because it is pure survival mode at this point. Not to start the video essay with complaining, but I believe it's in the spirit of female rage, no? Essentially, what I want to talk about today is how these different art forms I'm talking about engage our visual senses and how that really leads to a more honest and deeper connection to the message itself and what that really visual element does for us as viewers. So before we dive in, let's define female rage really quick. Female rage is traditionally a very abstract idea for many people. The metaphor that I like to use to really explain the impact and feeling of female rage is that there are little embers within my mind. And these embers are created by moments within my life as a femme person that have really changed the way that I've seen not only myself, but my gender, and just generally how I present myself. So, for example, the first time that I was called a bitch when I was 11 years old, that's an ember inside of my mind that's gonna change the way that I react to things. Or maybe the first time that I was spoken over in favor of a man who definitely didn't know as much as I did. These little moments are what builds up in a femme person's mind, these moments of misogyny, and these moments that really just make it so time after time after time you are feeling ignored. And so it's inevitable for somebody to want to snap when they reach a certain point, when the embers get to a point that you can just light a match and just create the biggest and brightest fire. And many of these art pieces that I'm going to be talking about today are representative of that burning, vicious fire that happens when a femme person reaches their limit. And because this is such a rooted idea, every single femme person's experience with this female rage idea is going to be so different. And I want to make sure and acknowledge that me as a white person, I am never going to understand or have an equivalent experience to a black woman and how that rage is different because of the systematic racism that is also being forced upon that woman. Or a trans woman as well, her experience is going to be so much different than mine. So that's one of the things that I like the most about art and how it's different from writing, because writing kind of puts a concrete meaning to things. I mean, sure, everyone can interpret things differently, but art is much more of an abstract, open expression, so everyone who sees something, everyone who watches a movie, everyone who sees a painting, listens to a song, will see this experience and apply it to themselves and allow themselves to feel it as if it was just written to them. And that is something so special and what really allows us to explore why female rage is such a cathartic feeling for so many femme people. So when we see other femme people embody this rage and embody this rage in ways that, oh God, we wish we could, is so cathartic. Even if it is a little voyeuristic, it's cathartic and it allows us to experience these emotions without, you know, actually having to go out and perhaps kill a bunch of men. It's for the better of the world!
New location. New outfit. I gotta keep you on your toes. I'm gonna go ahead and employ the Subway Surfer technique on you and give you multiple things to focus on. And also, maybe cutting strawberries is a massive metaphor. of female rage, but anyways. So the first thing, I'm gonna go ahead and gesture with the knife just to make sure everybody's aware that I have it. The first thing that I'm gonna start with is going to be feminine rage as portrayed artistically through cinema. So that's gonna be the first thing. And then we're going to transition to the artistic portrayal of female rage within historical art pieces. So those are the things I'm gonna be focusing on in terms of, you know, this female rage video essay. I do wanna make sure that I made the distinction to you guys that this essay isn't gonna be necessarily discussing the origins of female rage. And that isn't because I don't think it's important, it's just because that's not what this video is focusing on. The focus of this video is instead to show you guys how art portrays feminine rage very authentically in ways that writing couldn't do, right? In acting, they tell us all the time that you can't play emotion. And even though art is subjective, it shows emotion in a very raw, unfiltered way. That's why I wanted to focus on these specific mediums. I'm trying to take this really artistic approach to something that in the end is a very systematic patriarchal structure, right? So in saying that and in focusing on this artistic side, I don't want to ever disregard these foundations and you know, kind of just ignore it. So instead of talking about it and having it be kind of a side point in this video, I want to go ahead and give you guys resources on what you can look at and what you can read to really learn more about these systematic origins of female rage, especially when it comes to marginalized populations within the femme community, like I was talking about previously, like trans community and the BIPOC community. So at this point, I'm gonna list some things on the screen right now. Oh, wow, look at that. Looking at all these options. Oh, incredible. And I want you to take a screenshot of this, or maybe you already did pause the video, and I want you to look at these sources, right? Just because it's gonna not be as fun as watching a video essay, these things are still very valuable, and it's something that we should actively try to inform ourselves upon, especially since we need to have a better focus on intersectionality these days. I think it's really important to read these sources and to really educate yourself. At this point, now I only have like a rotten strawberry left, and one last strawberry. So we're gonna cut her, and we're gonna go ahead and transition into a discussion on cinema and female rage. While exploring female rage in cinema, I kind of gotten myself in this rabbit hole. I set this expectation of myself where I wanted everybody who watches this video to feel represented and to agree with what I'm saying. But I think that is definitely not probable at all. Everyone's gonna have different tastes in movies, and no movie ever is going to be perfect, especially with the female rage genre or with cinematic pieces that were made, you know, decades ago. There are gonna be other problematic themes in the movie itself. So I knew I couldn't use myself here as like a moral compass and this is the perfect movie with no problems, watch this. I rather wanted to kind of talk about a movie that is familiar to a lot of people, so we didn't have to go over the plot a lot, and it was kind of a known language, I suppose, that is built between the viewers here. That is not to say this movie is at all perfect. There are certainly moments where I'm like, oh, that's not good to say. And my favorites don't need to be your favorites, but without further ado, the cult classic that I am gonna be talking about today in relation to female rage is Jennifer's Body. Jennifer's Body is an American horror comedy released in 2009 and written by Diablo Cody. The story overall centers on two young women in high school, one named Jennifer and one who goes by the name Needy. Her real name is Anita, but the nickname that she appears to take on most of the time is Needy. The two have an incredibly homoerotic, and sometimes homo, just homo, relationship, despite the fact that they're quite literally opposites in almost every way. Jennifer is a cheerleader, and Needy is a bit of a loner. But for some reason, the two of them get along. Jennifer has a tendency to really manipulate Needy in many ways, and the whole kind of downfall of the movie begins with the fact that Jennifer convinces Needy to go to a dive bar and see one of the bands that she's recently been stalking. At this concert, a fire breaks out and all hell breaks loose. After escaping the dive bar, Jennifer and Needy run into the band. They offer to take them into the van. Needy doesn't have any desire to do so, but Jennifer does. So Jennifer goes into the van with these older men, and who would have known, they do not have the most pure intentions.
It turns out this band is here trying to fulfill a ritual in which they need a virgin sacrifice. They believe, and Jennifer tells them, that she is a virgin, so they take her into the woods and attempt to sacrifice her. We eventually learn that the ritual has gone horribly wrong, as Jennifer is in fact not a virgin. The ritual has somehow turned to make Jennifer a monster, in a sense. After the ritual, in which Jennifer escapes as this new other being, she shows up to Needy's house absolutely ravenous, and she's eating chicken and puking black goo. It's not the best look for little Miss Jennifer. Throughout the movie, we begin to learn that Jennifer needs to feed upon human flesh to continue to survive. And not only human flesh, but male humans. We see Jennifer going after several different men using different techniques, like taking advantage of her sexuality. And once she lures them into the place she needs, she ends up killing them and eating them. By doing this, she is getting revenge on the very same gender that turned her into this very monster itself. The men in the band thought they could take advantage of her. They thought that they could use her to further their own agenda, and at the expense of her own life, that they could win. But in reality, the situation has suddenly switched, and now Jennifer can use her own power to take advantage of men. This is where a lot of the cathartic element comes in, because we see stories in real life and in media every single day of men taking advantage of especially young women, and they always end up winning. In reality, women very rarely actually win. We go to court, we fight the battles, and we lose. And whether that is because of male privilege, or the failures of the justice system, or a combination of the both, the impact is the same. It is devastating, and it is horrific. So seeing stories such as this one, even though it is dialed up to an extreme level of justice, in a way, it feels so good to see Jennifer win. Even if that winning comes at the expense of lives. And some of them may be more innocent than others, but in the end, they are still men. It's like when men think it's funny to reveal to their female friends that, oh yeah, no, every single one of your guy friends has absolutely thought about you naked, or thought about sleeping with you. It's like, even if I am your friend, even if you are a good guy, there's this certain level of distrust that comes with, at least for me, the inherent relationship between a man and a woman. While the circumstance in this movie is centered on violence and obviously this big, gory, monstrous, supernatural element, female rage films absolutely do not have to be centered on that. They're centered on just this idea of this justice and this absolute cathartic revenge, maybe even a revenge tragedy. A female rage film could even be just a documentary of a woman who finally won in court. Big thing is the idea of this impact, what this story tells us. We could read books and stories of female rage all the time. I love reading books of female rage, but the physical act of seeing this represented in front of you and seeing someone who looks like you, who acts like you, win, is something that engages different parts of our brains than what just reading it would do. It's also very hard to write a certain emotion. In acting, they tell us all the time that you can't act an emotion, and that's true. Representing emotions is an incredibly nuanced and hard thing to do. So if we're using writing as a medium, which just allows for our words as the communicators, it's inherently more difficult. It's not impossible, but it's very difficult. When we use a visual medium like cinema, we have more than just words. We have music. We have the cinematography that can really try and tell this story through more than just words. And that's what really allows us to embody this idea of female rage. So now that we've gone over cinema, there's Momo, but also it's time to unveil one of my little papers back there. But first,
I am gonna need you to take a look at Momo. Hi, baby.
Our first little piece of paper on the female rage collage. That's just kind of a roadmap of what we're doing today is, of course, Jennifer. There we go. So now on to female rage in historical art. First, we're going to start with Artemisia Gentileschi. Artemisia is quoted in 1649 saying that the works will speak for themselves, so I am not going to go in depth on really, you know, doing a close reading in a sense of these pieces, as I don't think that would be authentic to what she would have wanted. I think that these pieces speak for themselves. They do embrace elements of gore and violence, so as a content warning before I do show them on the screen. Throughout her life, Artemisia faced an incredible amount of hardship, for lack of a better word. She faced personal trauma and public humiliation. Artemisia was forced to stand trial against one of her abusers who was her former friend. A quote within that trial that has always stuck out to me, and I will always remember, is her repetition of, "It's true, it's true, it's true." Artemisia was desperate to be believed. She was desperate to get justice, and yet it was not given to her. During her life, her work tended to be undervalued. It really only began to rise up in the 1970s during this feminist wave movement. While her trauma may have motivated her to make the kind of art that she did, it's dangerous to view her art as solely a representation of her trauma. In doing that, we kind of risk diminishing the work itself. If we just correlate it back to her real life, she chose these women in these paintings for a reason. Their stories are their own. And while many researchers and art historians do approach her art with an autobiographical approach, they state it is for more dramaturgical reasons rather than saying that's the only way to read her work. Again, that's why I'm going to remain brief with the really analysis that I do on these paintings, because the true essence of the paintings is to see it and to feel it for yourself. There's obviously clear shock value, but if you look at these expressions, the minute and nuanced nature behind these paintings rather than just the gore. If we think about what it means for a femme person to see this picture, what it means for a femme person to experience this picture, the pure animalistic rage behind it. The secondary artist that I would like to talk about today is Elisabetta Serrani. Similar to our previous artist, Elisabetta had her primary focus centered on women. Her paintings celebrated strength and dignity and power that was held by these women. It is stated that she chose to depict these women as their own independent historical agents. She didn't rewrite stories, she showed them from a different point of view. Her work emphasized the strength of these women in ways that the stories written about them or the historical records didn't. Not only is looking at these pictures a beautiful experience and a cathartic experience, it's a resonant experience as well. I think especially with historical art, when we see women from decades and centuries ago going through similar things that we went through in terms of emotionally, it emphasizes the community of what womanhood is. Even though I live in the 21st century and I live in this foreign world to them, centuries ago, another woman was also feeling scorned by a male figure, just as I am today. She understands who I am and what I'm going through in inconceivable ways. And that is what makes up this community of women. That's why female rage is a very unifying idea. It's a series of emotions or a series of just obstacles we have faced in life as femme people. While they divide us from men, they unite us within women. That community element is so emphasized by looking at historical art from centuries ago and seeing the same pain and the same joy and the same raw, honest emotion that is able to be portrayed in these paintings. And you know what time it is? To reveal the last three pieces of paper. Here we go. So, Now that we have barely scratched the surface, we are reaching the end of the video essay. I could go on for hours more. There are so many more things to cover here. We're gonna go ahead and try to wrap our heads around what exactly we just talked about. Isn't that right, Momo? Yes. Momo's a feminist. So we've talked a lot about the impact of the art, but also the process of creating the art itself is such a cathartic experience as well for the artist. I came across this really interesting essay or article by Kate Goh, and I wanted to read a quote from it that I thought was really impactful. Goh says that we cannot pick up a brush or type on a typewriter or mold clay when we are wailing on the floor in searing pain. We do so afterwards. We pick ourselves up and we channel the pain into art. Art that transcends the need to romanticize pain, but instead depicts it in its bare and gory details. We are honest with ourselves and in our art. But first, we have to pick ourselves up. When we choose to make art out of our pain, we are choosing to get better. We are choosing recovery. We are choosing growth. That choice negates the glorification of suffering and instead rebels against it and screams, "I tried. If I suffer again, I will try once more." That is the role of the artist, to scream back at the void which consumes us and perhaps offer antidote to life's suffering. I think that really kind of sums up why I wanted to talk about art in the first place. This whole essay, I've been talking about how art is just different than writing and it's different from all these other mediums. And it sounds almost pretentious to be like, no, it's just different, you don't understand. So maybe you were watching this video and you were consuming the images that were up on your screen and you're thinking about it. Instead of kind of intellectualizing these pictures or intellectualizing these scenes in this story, I challenge you to allow yourself just to take it in and to consume it. Allow yourself to try and explore the nuance of art, not only of the final product, but what went into creating it. And it's hard nowadays, especially since we can view art in many impersonal ways, like on a computer or a phone. I want to challenge you to try and really make it personal. Every pixel you see on your phone is equivalent to a brushstroke on a painting. And that brushstroke was done with purpose and with feeling, with emotion, with joy, with pain, with sorrow. That movie we watched, the amount of people behind that camera, the people in the writer's room, the editors, the producers, the production assistants, the director, the actors, the extras, the crew. The more that we are willing to listen, the more that we will be able to understand. We cannot grow if we do not listen. And sometimes listening is a more nuanced thing. I thank you so much for coming on this weird journey and dealing with me as my cat jumped around and as I recorded this so many times. And I thank you for watching this. And I thank you for your presence. And I thank you for listening.